The stratospheric polar vortex is a seasonal high-altitude atmospheric structure that develops in October, consolidates in winter, and dissipates in spring. The term has frequently, albeit incorrectly, attracted media attention in recent years. Sudden alterations in tropospheric circulation are frequently caused by its developments and deviations from the vertical axis of polar latitudes. A sudden spread of polar air towards mid-latitudes has been caused by variations, particularly in recent years. We shall learn that polar vortex is a structure that also exists on other worlds. It has historically been crucial in determining Earth's climate history, especially over the last 2.5 million years, which have been marked by a series of recurrent glacial periods and shorter interglacial periods. Due to the vagaries of the polar vortex, we periodically have the good fortune, or bad luck, to experience climate conditions that were typical during the last glacial maximum. We can momentarily travel back to Earth's conditions 20,000 years ago. However, there is a risk that over time, some say within a couple of decades at most, the polar vortex may finally collapse, ushering in a permanent ice age, rather than just a few advantageously cold weeks. Possibly, or just highly unlikely? Let's attempt to make sense of this. This inquiry is mostly aimed for people who live in regions with intermediate latitudes, such as the north of the United States or Northern Europe, who have undoubtedly encountered it. On a cool autumn night, you retire to sleep only to wake up feeling quite chilly. An unpleasant surprise occurs when you look outside and see that your automobile is covered in ice and half a meter of snow. One would most likely hurriedly put on the television in a quest to find out what has happened, just in time to hear your favorite meteorologist humorously explain that the reason for your small surprise was the abrupt collapse of something known as the polar vortex. Since temperatures dropped to dangerously low levels, in some places nearly 50 degrees below zero, in January 2014, this undoubtedly is when many discovered this for the first time. Even in the tough state of Minnesota, where the weather is generally quite atrocious, the governor decided to close schools to shield children from the cold. But perhaps we don't have to go so far back to see an example. The United States endured an abnormally cold spell in December 2022, with snowstorms and temperatures that resulted in at least 63 fatalities. The same thing occurred in February 2021, when Texas had some of the worst temperatures in over 30 years. As a result, at least 250 people died. In fact, the United States has been experiencing abrupt drops in temperature during the winter months for a number of years, seemingly going against predictions made by proponents of global warming. And yes, as the meteorologist mentioned earlier, these phenomena are connected to the Arctic vortex, the large low-pressure area that hovers over the North Pole. The polar vortex, however, new to us as it seemed at the time, was nothing new to scientists who had been researching it for at least 30 years. So, what is the polar vortex? The polar vortex, often referred to as the Arctic vortex, is a broad area of low pressure that, at high elevations above the North Pole, is semi-permanent. It is substantially larger than any other low pressure area and is almost always present, especially throughout the winter season. In this situation, we're talking about a vortex that covers the entire Arctic Circle, with a center roughly over the North Pole, which is not exactly little when we take into account the low-pressure regions affecting Central Europe that can have a diameter of 1,000 to 2,000 kilometers, or even more. With a circumference much greater than 5,000 kilometers, it can reach mid-latitudes. Typically between 12 and 50 kilometers above the troposphere and tropopause, where the majority of atmospheric processes take place, the stratosphere is where the vortex primarily forms. But when it's strong, this vortex at higher altitudes frequently also impacts the lower layers of the troposphere, resulting in the formation of a tropospheric polar vortex. In meteorology, the tropospheric vortex, which has a greater impact on air masses nearer the ground, is distinguished from the stratospheric one. The stratospheric vortex normally forms around September, achieves its greatest intensity in January and February, and disappears in April to early May. In contrast, the tropospheric vortex is present mostly throughout the year. This circulation can be compared to a huge spinning top that is over the North Pole and is packed with icy air. It resembles a two-story building with a ground floor and a first floor, much like a house. The troposphere in this illustration stands in for the region between sea level and a height of about 10 kilometers, where the meteorological phenomenon that we frequently study takes place. The stratosphere, which is located much higher on the first floor and reaches an altitude of about 50 kilometers, is divided from the troposphere by a ceiling known as the tropopause. Before moving on, don't forget to subscribe to our channel if you haven't already. Make sure to hit the notification bell so you don't miss out on any of our videos. Looking at this, one could see an almost circular cyclonic zone with air masses moving counterclockwise and an edge bordered by more or less prominent undulations if we could look down from a position in space above the North Pole. In meteorology, these waves are also referred to as Rossby waves. The Antarctic vortex, which is a comparable vortex that is also found above the South Pole, will be discussed a little later. But what stops this vortex from continuing to move or enlarge? The so-called warmer jet stream, a rapid airflow that acts as a barrier to the Arctic vortex, like the rim of a bowl, typically contains the Arctic vortex above the pole. This bowl of warm air efficiently traps the cold air in the center because it is denser there. It is difficult to go over the rim, or at least, it doesn't do so frequently. When Arctic temperatures rise, a portion of the cold wind vortex may break through the bowl's border, extending beyond the normal range of the jet stream and into continental areas. The terrestrial polar vortex is a frequent characteristic, in particular on all planets with a thick atmosphere, as has been recognized for decades. Where the air density might appear insufficient to produce such occurrences, similar cyclones have been observed near the poles of Venus and even Mars. However, although having a similar origin, a gaseous fluid encircling a celestial planet that rotates, these cyclone shapes and sizes significantly diverge from those of Earth's. The amazing hexagonal vortex that surrounds Saturn's North Pole is one famous example. The interplanetary Voyager 1 spacecraft initially noticed this particular hazy deformation of the planet in 1981, and the Cassini probe did so later in 2006. With better imaging capabilities, what first appeared to be an oddly geometric configuration changed into one of the oddest and most famous wonders of our solar system. A nearly perfect hexagon, with sides reaching about 13,840 kilometers, longer than the diameter of the Earth. Traditional explanations are unable to explain how this unusual structure came to be. According to one idea, atmospheric dynamics and Saturn's unusual rotation system are related. This concept, however, begs more questions than it answers. How can a gaseous planet have winds that are remarkably stable and orderly? And why a hexagon rather than any other shape being created by these winds? The impact of air waves is a different theory. The interaction of atmospheric winds and waves in a closed-loop current pattern is theorized to be the cause of it. However, even this idea is complicated and leaves several questions unanswered. However, it's intriguing to observe how the hexagonal pattern might be viewed as a much more geometric form than the wavy border of the Earth's polar vortex. The polar hexagon of Saturn is not an unusual occurrence. Neptune and Jupiter are two other gas giants that have similar structures. This raises the possibility of a general atmospherical mechanism that we, as of yet, are not completely aware of. Even Saturn's South Pole has a sizable vortex in the middle of it. But unlike the North Pole, the Hubble Space Telescope has revealed that the South Pole lacks any distinctive or continuous cloud formation, much less a hexagonal one. Returning to our domestic concerns, the polar vortex may appear to be a somewhat dependable natural system for balancing the climate in either hemisphere. However, in actual use, it isn't quite as seamless. To begin with, the jet streams that define the vortex's perimeter are wavy rather than round, with protrusions or indentations depending on the cold air or warm air flowing according to the latitudes as they approach the pole. The high wind speeds that make up the polar vortex's barrier can also occasionally change in strength. If these winds diminish too much, the vortex may be distorted and its limits may become even more erratic, allowing pockets of chilly air to escape. Even if the air spilling over the bowl's rims is milder than the usual Arctic winds, it is still quite cold. Even with mountain ranges to provide protection, significant snowfalls in Texas and Europe 2 years ago occurred due to this temperature. Speaking of which, why does the Arctic air spilling from the bowl of the vortex wreak havoc in North America, but not in Europe per se? Similar latitudes can be found in North America and Europe. New York's latitude is similar to Naples. However, simultaneous cold waves seldom impact both continents, and these winter events are significantly more regular and strong in North America. These differences have a variety of causes. First of all, while the polar vortex can also affect Europe, the air that reaches it travels over the North Atlantic rather than Canada. Due to the warm Gulf Stream, air over land masses is typically colder in winter than air over oceans, especially north of Europe. The key factor making Northern Europe's climate milder than that of Canada and most of North America is this stream. On the other hand, cold ocean currents have an impact on the shores of North America. In contrast, Europe may also rely on the Mediterranean Sea, another heat reservoir, much like the Gulf Stream. Mountains are another factor that makes North America more susceptible to cold air from the north. Northern winds are not blocked by the Rocky Mountains, which run from British Columbia, Canada, to New Mexico, USA, from north to south. Instead, they assist in directing these winds eastward. The main mountain range in Europe, the Alps, runs latitudinally. This prevents cold air from the north from entering and contributes to Italy's temperate climate. The Ural Mountains run longitudinally, separating European Russia from Asian Russia. Despite this, they also help to block cold air, especially the Arctic air from Siberia, which is the nearest significant cold continental area. Siberia is significantly farther away from Europe than northern Canada is from the United States. Therefore, its weather patterns don't always affect those of the continent. Of course, the question everyone is asking, and you might be too at this point, is the polar vortex influenced by climate change? The polar vortices can be distorted by warming temperatures, which can lead to abrupt cold periods, according to proponents of the hypothesis. The reason could be related to the fact that more Arctic sea ice is melting throughout the summer. The Arctic Ocean warms and releases extra heat during the winter as ice melts. The winds that create a barrier between these regions are weakened by the warmth because it somehow lessens the difference between the Arctic air and the atmosphere further south. The polar vortex then becomes weaker and is disrupted as a result. The vortex has a larger tendency to weaken in years when a sizable chunk of the Arctic sea ice is speeding its retreat, according to statistics from the last decade that support this notion. It should be noted that not everyone agrees that variations in Arctic sea ice can have this much of an impact on the polar vortex's stability. But if accurate, that would be worrying because the amount of Arctic sea ice changes from year to year and has been vanishing more and more quickly as of recently. The Atlantic would become more salted, and the well-known conveyor belt mechanism that allows the Gulf Stream to warm Northern Europe and North America would be severely disrupted if Arctic ice continues to melt at an even faster rate. Along with changes in air circulation in the Southern Hemisphere, this might cause a significant deterioration of the climate in the Northern Hemisphere. Additionally, the albedo effect of sunlight reflecting off the white ice might further lower world temperatures if the polar ice caps grow. The Arctic polar vortex may collapse in on itself if this pattern persists. This might set up all the circumstances for a mini ice age to start in the Northern Hemisphere. It's paradoxical because we may have to accept the possibility that global warming could result in a sharp decline in temperature throughout the year. So, my friends, it appears that our planet's environmental destiny is still very much up in the air. The best course of action could be to stay away from anything that could activate climate mechanisms that we still don't fully understand. What's your thoughts on this?